Hi and welcome. Today we will try to repair this Socket 7 motherboard. It is a DFI P5BTX/L revision C, and it is based on the Intel 430TX Triton II chipset, which came out in 1997 and was the last Socket 7 chipset from Intel. It obviously supports dual voltage CPUs like the Pentium MMX, and has an official supported FSB of up to 66 MHz, though unofficially it should work at up to 83 MHz. It has both SIM and DIMM memory slots and supports up to 256 MB of RAM, though only 64 MB is cacheable. The maximum cache size is 512 KB, and this board has indeed a 512 KB chip. The chipset has several modern features like USB, Ultra DMA 33, but it lacks AGP support. The CPU configuration is done through DIP switches, so you don't have to mess with jumpers, which is nice. Overall, it is a nice late Socket 7 motherboard with modern conveniences, though it is not as cool as some of the later Super Socket 7 boards designed for the AMD K62 CPUs. This particular board is completely dead. One of the power transistors just below the socket had visible damage from overheating, its legs were broken off, and the copper traces on the board had very visible heat damage. This is a very common failure for boards of this type. The failing part is usually the power transistor that regulates the voltage from 5 volts down to the CPU core voltage, that is 2.8 volts for the Pentium MMX. As you can see, I have already removed several capacitors, all of which had leaked. Even the back of the board was severely damaged, and the protective solder mask had chipped off, exposing the bare copper. Let's take a closer look at the broken transistor. It is an NMOS power transistor CEP6030L. According to its datasheet, it is a 52 amps part. The transistor legs from left to right are gate, drain, and source. The drain is connected to the body of the transistor, so there is continuity between the heatsink and the drain. As you can see, there is continuity between the gate and the source, which means that the transistor is bad. Strangely enough, there is no continuity between drain and source. Anyway, let's start with a visual inspection of the board. I don't see any damage except for several bent pins. These need to be fixed because they may be touching against other pins or traces on the board. I am bending them back with a small flathead screwdriver. The solder on some pins shows some cracks, so I will reflow them with some fresh solder. Oh, and this header pin has completely broken off, so this needs fixing too. Okay, now that the pins are fixed, let's look into the components near the transistor that failed. Right above the power transistor, there is this Schottky diode pair, which is connected to the transistor source leg. It is a PSR10C40CT. I could not find a datasheet for it, but as far as I can tell, the 40 stands for 40 volts of repetitive reverse voltage. Since this diode pair is between the power transistor source and the board's ground, we need to make sure that it works correctly, because otherwise this may cause a short to ground and damage the replacement transistor. To make desoldering easier, I am detaching the component from its heatsink. Now let's add some fresh solder. And now let me try to desolder it with a desoldering gun. The tip is too small for these pins. I will need to wait until the desoldering gun is cold to change the tip. This is a good opportunity to clean up the glass chamber, which collects all the solder that gets vacuumed by the tool. I also changed the filter and I think it made a huge difference. Okay, now let's test the diode pair. It seems to be working fine. Both diodes are identified correctly and they both have a forward voltage drop of 0.2 volts. Okay, let's continue the investigation. We need to make sure that there is no short to ground from the transistor source. The top pad is ground and the center pad is connected to the transistor source. And as you can see, it is showing some voltage drop which keeps rising. This is usually caused by a capacitor that is charging slowly. And indeed, there is continuity to this orange capacitor at the center of the socket. Let's switch to resistance mode. And yeah, we are seeing similar behavior. There's definitely no short. Okay, so let's solder the diode pair back onto the board. Now it's time to check the rest of the circuit. This 7-pin chip is a US2075 and it's a PWM switcher controller and voltage regulator combo. This means that the first part of the chip controls the pulse width modulation switching that drives the power transistor, and its job is to generate the CPU core voltage. The second part of the chip is a 3.3 volt voltage regulator that provides the I/O voltage. According to the schematic, pin 1 connects to the gate of the power transistor through a resistor. This resistor is this one here, which looks damaged. It makes sense because as we saw earlier, the transistor's gate pin was shorted to the source pin. Let me try to measure it. Well, it broke into little pieces as I attempted to measure it, so I will need to replace it with a new one. The datasheet suggests a value of 22 ohms. This is quite low, so I guess this resistor is probably meant to work as a fuse in case things go wrong. And it seems that it worked, as it stopped the damage from spreading to the PWM chip. Okay, let's solder a new resistor. I'm using an 805, which looks a bit larger than the ones on the board, but it should be easier to handle. And yeah, we're getting 23 ohms from the transistor gate to pin 1 of the PWM chip. Before moving on, let's take a closer look at the schematic to get a better idea of how the circuit works. The damaged power transistor is this one here. Its gate is controlled by the PWM controller chip, its drain is connected to 5 volts, and its source provides the 2.8 volts to the CPU core. The Schottky diode pair is this one, and as far as I can tell, its purpose is to protect the output from negative voltage. The core voltage is set by these resistors, which are connected to the circuit with the help of the dip switches. Finally, the top part of the circuit provides the 3.3 volts for I/O. And by the way, in case someone happens to have this exact board, this schematic lists some of the component labels found on the board. Now let's replace the power transistor. I'm going to use this IRF3205, which seems to handle a lot more current than the original one. It handles 110 amps, which is about twice as much current as the other one, so I guess it should be running cooler. But before soldering it on the board, let me try to cover the exposed copper with a thin layer of solder to protect it against corrosion. Same at the back. After placing the transistor, I realized that the solder pads for drain and source are completely gone, so there is nowhere to solder them onto. This also means that there is no continuity between the top and bottom traces, which is not ideal when handling such large currents. I will attempt to fix this with some solder wick. I will use it as a replacement for the damaged through-hole pads. Okay, this is quite messy, but I'm not sure there is a more elegant solution to this. The source pin on the right needs to be soldered onto the wick coming from the top layer. The drain pin needs to be soldered onto the large blob of solder that connects to the thick pin coming from the heatsink. The gate has a proper pad to solder onto, so it's fine. Okay, now it's time to insert the capacitors. I did not keep track of the values of the bad capacitors before throwing them away, so I'm going to use similar values to those listed in the US 2075 datasheet. Before inserting the CPU, we need to make sure that the VCC voltage is right. I have inserted the red wire at the VCC 2 pin and the yellow wire at the VCC 3 pin. VCC 2 should be the core voltage and VCC 3 should be the I/O voltage. VCC 2 is at 3.2 volts, which is reasonable. But hold on, why is this at 1 volt? Isn't this the I/O voltage pin? Shouldn't it be at 3.3 volts? Let's check pin 5 of the US 2075, where the 3.3 volts are actually generated. And yeah, this is indeed 3.3 volts. So what is going on in between? Well, there seem to be some resistors in between, so I guess this is normal. Anyway, since the 3.3 volt output of the PWM controller is correct, then the I/O voltage should be fine. I set the dip switches to 2.8 volts off camera, and I also confirmed that this is what I'm getting at the core voltage pin. So let's insert this Pentium 200 MMX CPU. Let's add a PC100 DIMM. I think this is a 64 MB module. And let's also insert the postcode diagnostic card. And let's power it on. Yeah, we're getting postcodes. Nice. Okay, so now let's add a CPU cooler, this S3 video card, and let's connect the keyboard. Well, that video card didn't work. I guess the PCI slots need some contact cleaner. So let's try this other video card. And yeah, it's booting. Now let's run some tests. We'll be right back. Okay, the board is working great, and it was a lot of fun fixing it. I'm quite pleased with it. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I hope to see you again soon. And as always, thanks for watching and goodbye!